Charles Ashmore's Trail by Ambrose Bierce. Ashmore's Trail by Ambrose Bierce. The family of Christian Ashmore consisted of his wife, his mother, two grown daughters, and a son of 16 years. They lived in Troy, New York, were well-to-do, respectable persons, and had many friends, some of whom, reading these lines, will doubtless learn for the first time the extraordinary fate of the young man. From Troy the Ashmores moved in 1871, or 1872, to Richmond, Indiana, and a year or two later to the vicinity of Quincy, Illinois, where Mr. Ashmore bought a farm and lived on it. At some little distance from the farmhouse was a spring with a constant flow of clear, cold water, whence the family derived its supply for domestic use at all seasons. On the evening of the 9th of November, 1878, at about 9 o'clock, young Charles Ashmore left the family circle about the hearth, took a tin bucket, and started toward the spring. As he did not return, the family became uneasy, and, going to the door by which he had left the house, his father called without receiving an answer. He then lighted a lantern, and with the eldest daughter, Martha, who insisted on accompanying him, went in search. A light snow had fallen, obliterating the path, but making the young man's trail conspicuous. Each footprint was clearly defined. After going a little more than halfway, perhaps 75 yards, the father, who was in advance, halted, and, elevating his lantern, stood peering intently into the darkness ahead.
"What is the matter, father?" the girl asked.
This was the matter. The trail of the young man had abruptly ended, and all beyond was smooth, unbroken snow. The last footprints were as conspicuous as any in the line. The very nail marks were distinctly visible. Mr. Ashmore looked upward, shading his eyes with his hat held between them and the lantern. The stars were shining. There was no cloud in the sky. He was denied the explanation which had suggested itself, doubtful as it would have been. A new snowfall with a limit so plainly defined. Taking a wide circuit round the ultimate tracks, so as to leave them undisturbed for further examination, the man proceeded to the spring, the girl following, weak and terrified. Neither had spoken a word of what both observed. The spring was covered with ice, hours old. Returning to the house, they noted the appearance of the snow on both sides of the trail its entire length. No tracks led away from it. The morning light showed nothing more. Smooth, spotless, unbroken, the shallow snow lay everywhere. 4 days later, the grief-stricken mother herself went to the spring for water. She came back and related that in passing the spot where the footprints had ended, she had heard the voice of her son and had been eagerly calling to him, wandering about the place, as she had fancied the voice to be now in one direction, now in another, until she was exhausted with fatigue and emotion. Questioned as to what the voice had said, she was unable to tell, yet averred that the words were perfectly distinct. In a moment the entire family was at the place, but nothing was heard, and the voice was believed to be an hallucination, caused by the mother's great anxiety and her disordered nerves. But for months afterwards, at irregular intervals of a few days, the voice was heard by several members of the family, and by others. All declared it was unmistakably the voice of Charles Ashmore. All agreed that it seemed to come from a great distance, faintly, yet with entire distinctness of articulation. Yet none could determine its direction, nor repeat its words. The intervals of silence grew longer and longer, the voice fainter and fainter, and by midsummer it was heard no more. If anyone knows the fate of Charles Ashmore, it is probably his mother. She is dead. The end of Charles Ashmore's Trail by Ambrose Bierce. The Dead Woman's Photograph from 25 Ghost Stories by W. Bob Holland. The Dead Woman's Photograph by W. Bob Holland. Virgil Holt is a photographer's assistant up in St. Paul, and a man of a good deal of taste. He has been in search of the picturesque all over the West, and hundreds of miles to the north in Canada, and can speak three or four Indian dialects, and put a canoe through the rapids. That is to say, he is a man of an adventurous sort and no dreamer. He can fight well, and shoot well, and swim well enough to put up a winning race with the Indian boys, and he can sit all day in a saddle and not dream about it at night. Wherever he goes, he uses his camera. "The world," Hoyt is in the habit of saying to those who will sit with him when he smokes his pipe, "was created in 6 days to be photographed. Man, and especially woman, was made for the same purpose. Clouds are not made to give moisture, nor trees to cast shade. We were created for the photographer." In short, Virgil Holt's view of the world is whimsical, and he doesn't like to be bothered with anything disagreeable. That is the reason that he loathes and detests going to a house of mourning to photograph a corpse. The horrible bad taste of it offends him partly, and partly he is annoyed having to shoulder, even for a few moments, a part of someone's burden of sorrow. He doesn't like sorrow, and would willingly canoe 500 miles up the cold Canadian rivers to get rid of it. Nevertheless, as assistant photographer, it is often his duty to do this very kind of thing. Not long ago he was sent for by a rich Jewish family at St. Paul to photograph the mother, who had just died. He was very much put out, but he went. He was taken to the front parlor, where the dead woman lay in her coffin. It was evident that there was some excitement in the household, and that a discussion was going on, but Holt wasn't concerned, and so he paid no attention to the matter. The daughter wanted the coffin turned on end, in order that the corpse might face the camera properly, but Holt said he could overcome the recumbent attitude and make it appear that the face was taken in the position that it would naturally hold in life. And so they went out and left him alone with the dead. The face was a strong and positive one, such as may often be seen among Jewish matrons. Holt regarded it with some admiration, thinking to himself that she was a woman who had been used to having her own way. There was a strand of hair out of place, and he pushed it back from her brow. A bud lifted its head too high from among the roses on her breast, and spoiled the contour of the chin, so he broke it off. He remembered these things later very distinctly, and that his hand touched her bare face two or three times. Then he took the photographs and left the house. He was very busy at the time, and several days elapsed before he was able to develop the plates. He took them from the bath, in which they had lain with a number of others, and went to work upon them. There were three plates, he having taken that number merely as a precaution against any accident. They came up well, but as they developed he became aware of the existence of something in the photograph which had not been apparent to his eye. The mysterious always came under the head of the disagreeable with him, and was therefore to be banished, so he made only a few prints and put the things away out of sight. He hoped that something would intervene to save him from attempting an explanation. But it is a part of the general perplexity of life that things do not intervene as they ought, and when they ought. So one day his employer asked him what had become of those photographs. He tried to evade him, but it was futile, and he got out the finished photographs and showed them to him. The older man sat staring at them a long time. "Holt," he said at length, "you're a young man, and I suppose you have never seen anything like this before, but I have. Not exactly the same, but a similar phenomenon have come my way a number of times since I went into the business, and I want to tell you there are things in heaven and earth not dreamt of." "Oh, I know all the tommy rot," cried Holt angrily. "But when anything happens, I want to know the reason why and how it was done." "All right," said his employer. "Then you might explain why and how the sun rises." But he humored the young man sufficiently to examine with him the bath in which the plates were submerged, and the plates themselves. All was as it should be, but the mystery was there, and could not be done away with. Holt hoped against hope that the friends of the dead woman would somehow forget about the photographs, but of course the wish was unreasonable, and one day the daughter appeared and asked to see the photographs of her mother. "Well, to tell the truth," stammered Holt, "those didn't come out as well as we could have wished."
"But let me see them," persisted the lady. "I'd like to look at them anyway."
"Well, now," said Holt, trying to be soothing, as he believed it was always best to be with women. To tell the truth, he was an ignoramus where women were concerned. "I think it would be better if you didn't see them. There are reasons why. He ambled on like this, stupid man that he was, and of course the Jewess said she would see those pictures without any further delay." So poor Holt brought them out and placed them in her hand, and then ran for the water pitcher, and had to be at the bother of bathing her forehead to keep her from fainting. For what the lady saw was this: over the face and flowers and the head of the coffin fell a thick veil, the edges of which touched the floor in some places. It covered the features so well that no hint of them was visible.
"There was nothing over my mother's face," cried the lady at length.
"Not a thing," acquiesced Hoyt. "I know, because I had occasion to touch her face just before I took the picture. I put some of her hair back from her brow."
"What does it mean, then?" asked the lady.
"You know better than I. There is no explanation in science. Perhaps there is some in psychology."
"Well," said the lady, stammering a little and colored, "Mother was a good woman, but she always wanted her own way, and she always had it, too."
"Yes."
"And she never would have her picture taken. She didn't admire herself. She said no one should ever see the pictures of her."
"So," said Holt meditatively, "well, she's kept her word, hasn't she?" The two stood looking at the pictures for a time. Then Holt pointed to the open blaze in the grate. "Throw them in," he commanded. "Don't let your father see them, and don't keep them yourself. They wouldn't be good things to keep."
"That's true enough," said the lady slowly, and she threw them in the fire.
And then Virgil Hoyt brought out the plates and broke them before her eyes. And that was the end of it, except that Hoyt sometimes tells the story to those who sit beside him when his pipe is lighted. The end of The Dead Woman's Photograph by W. Bob Holland.
The Diary of a Madman by Guy de Maupassant. Bell. The Diary of a Madman by Guy de Maupassant. He was dead. The head of a high tribunal, the upright magistrate, whose irreproachable life was a proverb in all the courts of France. Advocates, young counselors, judges had saluted, bowing low in token of profound respect, remembering that grand face, pale and thin, illumined by two bright, deep-set eyes. He had passed his life in pursuing crime and in protecting the weak. Swindlers and murderers had no more redoubtable enemy, for he seemed to read in the recesses of their soul their most secret thoughts. He was dead now, at the age of 82. Honored by the homage and followed by the regrets of a whole people. Soldiers in red breeches had escorted him to the tomb, and men in white cravats had shed on his grave tears that seemed to be real. But listen to the strange paper found by the dismayed notary in the desk where the judge had kept filed the records of great criminals. It was entitled, Why? June 20th, 1851. I have just left court. I have condemned Blondel to death. Now, why did this man kill his five children? Frequently, one meets with people to whom killing is a pleasure. Yes, yes, it should be a pleasure. The greatest of all, perhaps. For is not killing most like creating? To make and to destroy. These two words contain the history of the universe, the history of all worlds, all that is, all. Why is it not intoxicating to kill? June 25th. To think that there is a being who lives, who walks, who runs. A being? What is a being? An animated thing which bears in it the principle of motion, and a will ruling that principle. It clings to nothing, this thing. Its feet are independent of the ground. It is a grain of life that moves on the earth. And this grain of life, coming I know not whence, one can destroy at one's will. Then nothing. Nothing more. It perishes. It is finished. June 26th. Why, then, is it a crime to kill? Yes, why? On the contrary, it is the law of nature. Every being has the mission to kill. He kills to live, and he lives to kill. The beast kills without ceasing, all day, every instant of its existence. Man kills without ceasing to nourish himself. But since, in addition, he needs to kill for pleasure, he has invented the chase. The child kills the insects he finds, the little birds, all the little animals that come in his way. But this does not suffice for the irresistible need of massacre that is in us. It is not enough to kill beasts. We must kill man, too. Long ago, this need was satisfied by human sacrifice. Now, the necessity of living in society has made murder a crime. We condemn and punish the assassin. But as we cannot live without yielding to this natural and imperious instinct of death, We relieve ourselves from time to time by wars. Then a whole nation slaughters another nation. It is a feast of blood, a feast that maddens armies and intoxicates the civilians, women and children, who read by lamplight at night the feverish story of massacre. And do we despise those picked out to accomplish these butcheries of men? No. They are loaded with honors. They are clad in gold and in resplendent stuffs. They wear plumes on their heads and ornaments on their breasts. And they are given crosses, rewards, titles of every kind. They are proud, respected, loved by women, cheered by the crowd, solely because their mission is to shed human blood. They drag through the streets their instruments of death, and the passerby, clad in black, looks on with envy. For to kill is the great law put by nature in the heart of existence. There is nothing more beautiful and honorable than killing. June 30th. To kill is the law, because nature loves eternal youth. She seems to cry in all her unconscious acts, "Quick, quick, quick!" The more she destroys, the more she renews herself. July 2nd. It must be a pleasure, unique and full of zest, to kill, to place before you a living, thinking being, to make therein a little hole, nothing but a little hole, and to see that red liquid flow which is the blood, which is the life, and then to have before you only a heap of limp flesh, cold, inert, void of thought. August 5th. I, who have passed my life in judging, condemning, killing by words pronounced, killing by the guillotine those who had killed by the knife, if I should do as all the assassins whom I have smitten have done, I, who would know it? August 10th. Who would ever know? Who would ever suspect me? Especially if I should choose a being I had no interest in doing away with. August 22nd. I could resist no longer. I have killed a little creature as an experiment, as a beginning. Jean, my servant, had a goldfinch in a cage hung in the office window. I sent him on an errand, and I took the little bird in my hand where I felt its heart beat. It was warm. I went up to my room. From time to time, I squeezed it tighter. Its heart beat faster. It was atrocious and delicious. I was nearly choking it. but I could not see the blood. Then I took scissors, short nail scissors, and I cut its throat in three strokes, quite gently. It opened its bill. It struggled to escape me. But I held it. Oh, I held it. I could have held a mad dog. And I saw the blood trickle. And then I did as assassins do, real ones. I washed the scissors and washed my hands. I sprinkled water and took the body, the corpse, to the garden to hide it. I buried it under a strawberry plant. It will never be found. Every day I can eat a strawberry from that plant. How one can enjoy life when one knows how. My servant cried. He thought his bird flown. How could he suspect me? Ah. August 25th. I must kill a man. I must. August 30th. It is done. But what a little thing. I had gone for a walk in the forest of Vern. I was thinking of nothing, literally nothing. See, a child on the road. A little child eating a slice of bread and butter. He stops to see me pass and says, "Good day, Mr. President." And the thought enters my head, "Shall I kill him?" I answer, "You are alone, my boy?" "Yes, sir." "All alone in the wood?" "Yes, sir." The wish to kill him intoxicated me like wine. I approached him quite softly, persuaded that he was going to run away. And suddenly, I seized him by the throat. He held my wrists in his little hands, and his body writhed like a feather on the fire. Then he moved no more. I threw the body in the ditch, then some weeds on top of it. I returned home and dined well. What a little thing it was! In the evening, I was very gay, light, rejuvenated, and passed the evening at the prefect's. They found me witty. But I have not seen blood. I am not tranquil. August 31st. The body has been discovered. They are hunting for the assassin. Ah. September 1st. Two tramps have been arrested. Proofs are lacking. September 2nd. The parents have been to see me. They wept. Ah. October 6th. Nothing has been discovered. Some strolling vagabond must have done the deed. Ah, if I had seen the blood flow, it seems to me I should be tranquil now. October 10th. Yet another. I was walking by the river after breakfast, and I saw, under a willow, a fisherman asleep. It was noon. A spade, as if expressly put there for me, was standing in a potato field nearby. I took it. I returned. I raised it like a club, and with one blow of the edge, I cleft the fisherman's head. Oh, he bled, this one. Rose-colored blood. It flowed into the water quite gently. And I went away with a grave step. If I had been seen, I should have made an excellent assassin. October 25th. The affair of the fisherman makes a great noise. His nephew, who fished with him, is charged with the murder. October 26th. The examining magistrate affirms that the nephew is guilty. Everybody in town believes it. October 27th. The nephew defends himself badly. He had gone to the village to buy bread and cheese, he declares. He swears that his uncle had been killed in his absence. Who would believe him? October 28th. The nephew has all but confessed, so much have they made him lose his head. Ah, justice! November 15th. There are overwhelming proofs against the nephew, who was his uncle's heir. I shall preside at the sessions. January 25th, 1852. To death, to death, to death. I have had him condemned to death. The Advocate General spoke like an angel. Yet another. I shall go to see him executed. March 10th. It is done. They guillotined him this morning. He died very well, very well. That gave me pleasure. How fine it is to see a man's head cut off. Now I shall wait. I can wait. It would take such a little thing to let myself be caught. The manuscript contained more pages, but told of no new crime. Alienist physicians, to whom the awful story has been submitted, declare that there are in the world many unknown madmen, as adroit and as terrible as this monstrous lunatic. End of The Diary of a Madman.
An Eye for an Eye by William A. McGarry. An Eye for an Eye by William A. McGarry. an almost imperceptible zephyr from the elm-shaded avenue eddied through the raised windows of Clayton's beautiful mansion, swaying the silken curtains ever so slightly. A little cloud of pungent powder smoke lazily rose, disintegrated, and was carried away. Clayton, in evening dress, stood stupidly over the prone bodies of Marsden, his lifelong chum, and she who had been his wife. The revolver, given him by the dead man on their first trip after big game, was in his hand. It was an automatic, needing but the slightest pressure to let loose its messengers of death. A pool of blood from the breast of the woman stained the carpet a darker hue.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.